Thank you very much for that welcome. It's lovely to be here with you. I have to leave a little while later to fly back to the UK because I'm doing a rather foolish thing tomorrow, running the London Marathon for in support of Help the Hospices. So it's at the other end of life. I come originally from New Zealand. I was a general surgeon. I've been 20 years with CMF, and Christian Medical Fellowship seeks to unite and to equip Christian doctors and medical students to live and to speak for Jesus Christ. And one of the most important things I think we do is to act as a voice for the vulnerable. And I'm really speaking from a very sad situation in Britain. And I think the thing I want to impart to you most of all today is that very, very small changes in the law have huge consequences, because once the right to abortion is established for any cases at all, you will have people who will push the envelope, who will go for incremental extension. You'll get a slippery slope, and you end up ultimately with the situation that we had in the UK. And it's the very hard cases that are used most effectively by the pro-abortion lobby to bring about these changes of the law. And let's never forget that the 1967 Abortion Act came about in the light of the thalidomide disaster of the early 1960s. So one of its drivers was babies who were damaged as a result of the thalidomide drug that women took in pregnancy and ended up having babies born with abnormalities. So we need to be vocal on the very hardest cases, and we need to stand up for the most vulnerable and to be a voice for the voiceless. And these are the facts in the UK today. We have what was originally thought to be a restricted law, but has led to 200,000 abortions a year, 8 million abortions since 1967, and one in every five pregnancies ends in abortion in Britain. And whereas abortion is available for able-bodied babies up to 24 weeks, the threshold of disability, when we're talking about disabled babies, those with special needs, it's right up to the moment of birth at 40 weeks. That may shock you, but that is the case. And if we just focus down on those babies, in the 10-year period between 2002 and 2010, there were almost 18,000 babies with special needs who were aborted, what we call ground E abortions in Britain. They make up 1% of the total. And the overwhelming majority of these were actually had conditions that were fully compatible with life outside the womb. They were impaired like all of us are, disabled like all of us are in some way, but nonetheless their lives were judged as not worth living. And amongst these babies were almost 4,000 with Down syndrome. 91% of all babies diagnosed with Down syndrome in the womb now in Britain are aborted. 20 with cleft lip or palate, many easily preventable or curable conditions. And almost 1,200 of them were aborted after 24 weeks. That's the age of viability. We now know that although a pregnancy lasts for 40 weeks, a baby born at 23 or 24 weeks in the very best centres will much more likely survive than not now with good neonatal care. And we see these amazing pictures. This is baby Jacob, the youngest baby ever to survive at just under 22 weeks after being conceived. And now we're in this position where we also know much more about the humanity of the preborn baby from these amazing high-resolution 4D ultrasounds that we're seeing. And this baby doesn't look like a newborn baby at 40 weeks, and that's because it's at 24 weeks, 16 weeks younger, but nonetheless, with the right care, a baby that big can be brought through, and many of them survive without any disability at all now with good care. In fact, we treat them as patients in many ways. This is a famous, somewhat iconic picture of a surgeon carrying out surgery on a baby in the womb at 24 weeks, and you can see the little hand coming out, and the surgeon described the hand coming out of the womb through the incision he'd made and grasping his finger. And fetal surgery is now a recognized specialty. And between the ages of 18 weeks, when they're big enough to be operated upon, and up to 30 weeks, because beyond that you'd have the baby born and operate on it after birth, but we are able to do in the best hands now a variety of different procedures to correct things like spina bifida, remove certain kinds of tumours and so on. And it can either be done open like this, where an incision is made in the womb and the operation is carried out and the baby stitched back up again until the time when it is born normally, or it can be done through what we call a minimally invasive technique through the use of needles and other instruments that are placed in that can be used to restore damaged or closed heart valves or stop abnormal vascular connections, what we call stop twin-to-twin transfusion. The first case, incidentally, of that was Jacob and Esau in the Old Testament, or to repair diaphragmatic hernias. So some conditions now, we treat babies as full human beings, as we absolutely should, and do this. Now, what are ground E abortions for disability done for in the UK? Well, there are a variety of conditions, but if we look at the figures for 2012, you'll see that almost half of them, 44%, are for congenital malformations, and the biggest group of those of all are malformations of the nervous system. So we're talking about spina bifida predominantly, but also cardiovascular, heart defects, and so on. So many of these things surgically correctable, treatable, manageable. Just over a third are for chromosomal abnormalities. The three most common, Patau's, Edwards, and Down syndrome, which you almost all most certainly will have heard of, and then there are other conditions as well. And a couple of years ago, nine of us, all leaders of different organisations, we wrote to the Daily Telegraph, one of our national newspapers in Britain, and we were making the point that after the incredible Paralympics in Britain, why was it that we had the schizophrenic attitude where we treated disabled people performing in the Olympics in one way, quite rightly boasting and glorifying in their wonderful achievements, and yet at the other end of life we were actually killing people with exactly the same disabilities in the womb. And we said this was a case of eugenic abortion. And it was not long after this that a newly elected Christian MP by the name of Fiona Bruce brought together a consultation on this whole anomaly we had in British law, whereby disabled babies and able-bodied babies were being treated in very different ways. And this was given national news coverage when she launched a consultation and took evidence from a whole variety of different witnesses. And you can Google this and you can find the full report, which is well worth reading if you read the executive summary of it. But she interviewed families with disabled children, she interviewed doctors and nurses, she interviewed disability rights activists and put together this consultation. Now, it has not yet become law, it's not yet led to a bill, but nonetheless it is research that had not previously been done and which we hope to be able to build on as we try to push back the liberal law that we have in Britain. And the Commission came out with several recommendations. The first is that they said that the current law was profoundly discriminatory. Now, what was interesting here was that there were disability rights activists who were not coming from any pro-life or Christian or any other faith background whatsoever, who actually were pro-choice, pro-abortion in their beliefs. But they were very upset about the fact that there was not a level playing field and that disabled babies were being treated in a different way than able-bodied babies. And one of the conclusions of this commission was that discrimination, that the current law was actually discriminatory and that needed to be addressed. And I think the lesson we can learn from that is that there are occasions where we can work together in what we might call a co-belligerent fashion with people who might not share all our views but will run part of the race with us. They also said that defining serious handicap would discriminate against people with specific disabilities. And the disability rights lobby were very, very strong on this. They said, if you take the view that you can kill people with some disabilities and not with others, you're discriminating against people with more serious disabilities. And we would not do that in any other law for people who were born, so why are we doing it for those who were pre-born? But one of the most distressing things that came out of this consultation was the quality of the information that was coming from many health professionals, pushing people down the road of abortion and not offering them any alternatives. And they called it biased, negative, uninformed, and incorrect. And sadly, doctors were right at the beginning of this. And if we look at some of the quotes here, parents are steered towards abortion and feel that they are not received adequate information about other options, including palliative care after birth and adoption, as well as the reality of living with a child with disability. So the commission showed that actually there was a huge amount of support and information, contact with families with children with disabilities, which was just not being made available. People were being steered down a conveyor belt to abortion, and they were made to feel guilty if they chose to carry on with a baby with a disability. To give a family a diagnosis of a disability and then immediately follow that up with the advice that they can have a termination without any other information is simply not acceptable in a civilized society. And some of you will be familiar with the writings of Melinda Reist, who is an Australian pro-lifer who has done a lot of work in this area and has written a book called Defiant Birth. And women who have a defiant birth are those who are carrying a baby with a disability. They're told that they should abort it. They're told this by health professionals. Pressure's put upon them, and they're defiant, and they say, absolutely no, this is my baby, and I'm going to care for it and carry it through. And Melinda Rice calls abortion for disability a coercive offer because it so often comes with the pressure that it's the right thing to do it. And there's a huge amount of misinformation around this area. This was a blog I did about a year ago based on some newspaper coverage in Ireland, which really incensed me. And I'm sure many of you will be familiar with this, but there was a story that was run by just about every newspaper in Ireland last year about abortion for disability that was filled with misinformation. And I traced it right back to try and find the original source of it. And this was the claim: about 1,500 cases of fatal fetal abnormalities are reported each year in Ireland, with about 80% of the women traveling abroad for early inducement or terminations. And that was all over all your newspapers and just repeated from one to the other. And I read that and I thought, well, 80% of 1,500 is 1,200 abortions carried out in Britain, because that's where they go, for fatal fetal abnormalities every year. And I knew there were about 4,000 Irish women having abortions in Britain each year. So, in other words, a third of them have fatal fetal abnormalities? No. There's something crazily wrong here. So I went and back and looked at the figures. And then we had this extraordinary claim from one of your TDs, John Halligan, who said that 1,500 women in Ireland each year had to deal with a pregnancy with a baby would live for just minutes outside the womb. Now, where he got that from, I don't know. It was he took the number 1,500 and gave some new meaning to it. And so, but this is just an example of the lies that people tell in order to further their case. And let's look at it in a bit more detail. So
the Irish media claimed 1,200 Irish women have abortions for fetal abnormality in the UK every year,
and John Halligan said 1,200 have it for fatal fetal abnormality, where they die within minutes. So we went back and we asked the Department of Health in Britain just how many women from Ireland were having abortions for underground D, for any kind of fetal abnormality at all, fatal or otherwise. And these were the figures that we got for the 5 years, 27, 29, 42, and so on. So complete lies propagated by the Irish media. And I went back and looked at the diagnoses on these and worked out how many of them had fatal fetal abnormalities. In other words, that they would die, either be stillborn or die within minutes of birth. About four a year. Four against 15, against 1,200, that's 300 times out. And yet these figures were not challenged. And so, but nonetheless, we do need to encounter and deal with the very most difficult cases. And this is why I wanted to close by talking about the whole issue of anencephaly. Because I was called, as Owen said, to do an interview with Steve Nolan, who's a strongly pro-abortion BBC presenter in Northern Ireland. And this was after Stephen Nolan had taken this woman who was diagnosed with a baby with anencephaly at 20 weeks, halfway through pregnancy, and he accompanied her to Britain to have an abortion. And then he brought her back and he gave her an international media platform when she was right in the middle of her trauma and crisis. And he did it in order to force a change in Northern Ireland and also more broadly in Ireland itself. And anyway, I wrote a blog about it. Nolan read the blog. He invited me onto his program, and I went on the program. And you can imagine the very first question I got was, "So, Dr. Saunders, you would force this poor woman to have this anencephalic with no brain, would you?" And so on. You know, so you can imagine what these people are like. And I said, "Stephen, before you can even start to think about answering that question, you have to ask yourself two really crucial questions. The first thing you need to ask is, what is it that you're actually talking about? What is a baby with anencephaly? And the second thing you have to ask is, how do you care best for a woman in deep crisis who's just the most devastating news in her whole life that she has a baby that not only is severely disabled but is going to die within hours or at most days of birth?" Those are the questions you need to grapple with. It's always good if you can turn it on the interviewer, and he didn't really know what to say, except that, well, how would you answer those questions? So he gave me then 25 minutes to unpack it, which I very gratefully took. And and the first, what we have to do is to counter the lies and to speak the truth into these situations, because it's the truth that sets free and it's lies which enslave. And the stronghold of the pro-abortion movement is lies. And anencephaly, it's a very severe form of spina bifida where the cerebral hemispheres, the thinking part of the brain, does not develop. It affects about 1 in 1,000 pregnancies. It is probably the most severe of all the possible fetal abnormalities you can have. Many of them die during pregnancy, which means that fewer, 3 in 10,000, are born. Most die within hours or days of birth. 95% are aborted in the UK. We have just over 200 a year with this condition. And you see there's a father there holding his little boy who's just going to live a few more hours or days with anencephaly. So it's a condition which is not common, but it's also not rare either. And I said to Stephen Nolan, "What is a baby with anencephaly?" Well, the first thing you've got to appreciate is that this is a human being, a precious human life. It's not brain dead. It breathes without a ventilator. It may feel and sense in different ways than we do, but we can't use these babies as organ donors like brain dead people. They're seriously brain damaged, like people with dementia or stroke or severe injury. They are dependent relatives. They are disabled people with special needs. And in asking the question how we should handle these situations, we have to ask, well, how do we treat any deeply dependent relatives, people with special needs, precious human beings with severe disabilities? How do we treat people who are dying? And you'll notice each of these pictures I'll show you, I won't show you the disability because it's not pretty to look at, but you'll notice that each of these babies, which has anencephaly on these slides, is wearing a little hat. And this is just a practical thing, but one thing you do with a baby is born with anencephaly, you put a little hat on its head. And the reason you do that is because it covers the deformity. And then what happens is that the eyes of the parents are then attracted to the face. And they look at the eyes and the nose and the mouth, which are usually absolutely normal and beautiful to look at. Because all of us, if we see someone with a disability, our eyes just go there, don't they? We look at what is abnormal. And so you put a little hat on these babies, and this is what they do. So how do we respond to people who are terminally ill in any other circumstance. If we're told someone has only days or hours to live or weeks to live, well, we treat them with good palliative care. We provide pain relief. We give them food and fluids. We give them human warmth and love. So why should we treat babies who are terminally ill in any different way? And I said to Nolan, pregnancy is actually the most intimate form of hospitality there is. Can you think of any other more intimate form of hospitality than when you're looking after a baby in your own body and providing it with all the care that it needs? But it's also incredibly important for the parents, because what the parents need in these tragic situations is to be able to come through to what we call closure in a way where they are presiding over being part of a good death and being involved in caring and loving for their baby and bonding with it. And then, of course, experiencing the pain of loss is the best way through. And in fact, abortion for anencephaly can be profoundly damaging to a mother's mental health and to that of a family because of the guilt and the unresolved bereavement that often follows. And when I wrote about this on my blog, I got letters from all over the world from families where they had experienced this. This is just one of them. I recently carried my baby girl, Sophia, diagnosed with anencephaly, to term, and we not only made it our aim to celebrate her life weekly as she grew in my womb, but to celebrate with her when she was born. God gave us 10 precious hours with her alive after she was born, and though our hearts hurt now, we have no regrets of the choices we made to carry our little girl. I pray more and more women know they have another option, and the option to give life is so incredibly rewarding. And, you know, sometimes we just think about the few hours and days after, but any woman knows who has had a baby, it's those 9 months of carrying in that close, intimate relationship that are part of that short life, lives that are complete regardless of the fact that they are short. Contrary to every historic ethical code, all abortion, and exchanges abortion just one set of problems for a whole new set of problems. When you have a baby with a disability, it's going to change your life forever, regardless of what you do. But the best choice is to care for it and love this baby. And it's cases like this which help us, I think, force us to acknowledge and to face our very deepest prejudices. And as we've seen in the UK, once you open the door, it goes more and more open to all sorts of horrors. And I just wanted to close by talking very briefly about what's happening elsewhere in Europe. But in the Netherlands at the moment, where euthanasia is legal under a system called the Groningen Protocol, babies with disabilities are being euthanized. They're being given lethal injections. And in fact, even though it's against the law in that country, it happens according to a protocol. There are no convictions, no doctors are brought to task. And this article in the New England Medical Journal highlighted the fact that 22 babies with spina bifida had been given lethal injections over a period of 7 years. And in fact, in reality, they said there were 15 to 20 cases a year. And then we've just seen this year in Belgium, where the euthanasia of children of all ages with terminal conditions has been legalized in February of this year by a bill that's gone through both passes. Now, we know that euthanasia is out of control in Belgium, but what happens when you change the law to allow these kinds of practices, whether it's abortion or euthanasia, three things happen. The first is people act up to the new law. The second is some will go beyond it. And the third, and perhaps the most tragic, is the public conscience changes so that people then accept things that they would never have accepted before. I started by talking about encouraging people to live and speak for Jesus Christ, and this is where I want to finish as well. This is one of my favorite paintings of the Passion. It's Salvador Dali's St. John of the Cross. And the reason I love this painting so much is because it shows a muscular Christ who has made the decision to go to the cross to pay for our sins, looking down on, involved in self-giving to the world. It's the exact opposite of what we see in the Buddha, who's detached self-absorption. This is involved self-giving. giving.
This is our Saviour. And I think when as believers we're called to carry the cross, I think it means two things in this area. The first is that we are called to speak up for those who have no voice, to speak the truth and to take the opposition that will inevitably come when we do put our heads above the parapet. But I think the other thing it involves is being willing to be part of the solution, to bear one another's burdens. And Paul's letter to the Galatians says, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. In a sense, it sums up Christian morality, I think. It's a morality where the strong make sacrifices for the weak, if necessary, lay down their lives for the weak. And the thing about being humans is that we are all, at some time in our lives, burdens. And that's fine. That's part of being human. We're meant to be mutually burdensome. There are times when we are dependent, and that is so that we can be interdependent. That is incredibly important that we model that as a Christian community. I was up in Northern Ireland just last week, and I had the privilege of going and seeing C.S. Lewis's three houses where he lived as a boy in East Belfast. I'm a great fan of C.S. Lewis, but he says here, one of these quotes I love, that God sees us because he loves, and he loves although he sees. He sees because he loves, and he loves although he sees. And we have to remember that when we look on people with profound special needs, or perhaps even disabilities that are ugly to look at, that Christ looked on us in all our moral ugliness, and yet he still gave himself for us, and he calls us to walk in his footsteps. Thank you. What I want.